One of the worst stains on Western history is the transatlantic slave trade. Over 12 million Africans were forcibly taken from their home to the Western world. They travelled in cramped, inhuman conditions. Up to a quarter of them died while they were on the journey. Sadly, slavery has been a near universal part of human civilization. Almost every empire and nation since ancient times has permitted the practice of slavery. Even the abolition of the slave trade did not stop slavery itself. The Walk Free Global Slavery Index estimates that there are 49.6 million people globally held in modern slavery. More people are enslaved today than at any point throughout history. All this is bad enough, but slavery does not end there. According to the Bible, slavery affects every single human being. None of us are born free. We start out as slaves, whether we know it or not. Let's look into it. In the last session, we saw that God promised Abraham that he would have a son. Well, Abraham did have a son, Isaac, and Isaac had Jacob, and Jacob became the father of 12 boys, whose descendants became the 12 tribes of Israel. They ended up leaving Canaan and settling in Egypt. One of the sons, Joseph, became second in command of Egypt and saved the Egyptians from famine. It's an involved story, but if you know the basic plot of Andrew Lloyd Webber's musical, Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat, then you'll be familiar with the basics. All of this is told in the rest of the book of Genesis, and this is your regular reminder that it's important to read this for yourself. Don't just take my word for it. We're going to pick up the story at the beginning of the book of Exodus, which is the next book on from Genesis. Then a new king, to whom Joseph meant nothing, came to power in Egypt. "Look," he said to his people, "the Israelites have become far too numerous for us. Come, we must deal shrewdly with them, or they will become even more numerous, and, if war breaks out, will join our enemies, fight against us, and leave the country." So they put slave masters over them to oppress them with forced labour, and they built Pithom and Ramesses as store cities for Pharaoh. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread. So the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites and worked them ruthlessly. They made their lives bitter with harsh labour in brick and mortar, and with all kinds of work in the fields. In all their harsh labour, the Egyptians worked them ruthlessly. So the Egyptians feared the Israelites and decided to enslave them. This is a story which has been tragically repeated throughout history. One nation fears another and so decides to deal with it through violence and oppression. The Egyptians made the Israelites make bricks for them and build cities like Pithom and Ramesses. There's a humorous episode of the cartoon Futurama called A Pharaoh to Remember, where the characters become enslaved on a planet which looks suspiciously like ancient Egypt.
"You know the worst thing about being a slave? They make you work, but they don't pay you or let you go.
That's the only thing about being a slave."
It's a funny episode, but the truth is that slavery is no joke. Slavery robs us of something fundamental to being human: freedom. Freedom is not a nice to have, but an ideal which many people have fought and died for. The 18th century American politician Patrick Henry once gave a famous speech where he said, "Is life so dear, or peace so sweet, as to be purchased at the price of chains and slavery? Forbid it, Almighty God. I know not what course others may take, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death." He was arguing that life is not worth living if it is to be lived in servitude. Freedom is so important that it's worth dying for. But sometimes freedom cannot be fought for. In the case of the Israelites, the Egyptians had the upper hand. They were the military superpower of their day. They had the weapons, the money, the army. The Israelites couldn't just fight their way to freedom. In fact, it seemed like they were fresh out of options. So, what were they to do? Before we get on to that question, let's take a moment to think more deeply about what slavery is and how it relates to us. If you think back to the first session, I said, most of the rest of the Old Testament is about the history of Israel. But significantly, it contains many pictures and prophecies of what Jesus would come to do. The Exodus is perhaps the greatest picture in the Old Testament of what Christ would come to do. It's far more than a story about people being delivered from slavery. How does it relate to us and Christ? Let's think about what slavery is. Slavery is, according to the dictionary, the condition of being legally owned by someone else and forced to work for or obey them. At the heart of slavery is compulsion. We are compelled to do things that we don't want to do. In short, our choice is taken away. You can't do what you want to do. You can't spend your time in the way that you want.
You know what else stinks about being a slave? The hours.
Now, you might think it's not like that for us in the Western world. Our ancestors fought against tyranny to secure our freedoms. Many of them gave their lives. And although freedom is under threat in many ways today, we do still enjoy liberties which many people would die for through the world. When I was at school, if someone didn't like what you were doing, you'd shrug your shoulders and say, well, it's a free country, isn't it? We want to live in freedom, not in slavery. However, the Bible says that all of us are actually born as slaves. We are not born free. We are born in slavery. How so? Let me quote from what Jesus said in John's Gospel. To the Jews who had believed in him, Jesus said, "If you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." They answered him, "We are Abraham's descendants and have never been slaves of anyone. How can you say that we shall be set free?" Jesus replied, "Very truly I tell you, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed." Jesus says that his teaching will set us free. The Jews he was speaking to, quite naturally, replied, "But we've never been slaves." To which Jesus says, "Ah, that's where you're wrong. Anyone who sins is a slave to sin." Jesus tells us that sin is a kind of slavery. In fact, it's the worst kind of slavery. Sin doesn't force us to do things against our will. Sin is even more insidious than that. A moment ago, I said that slavery meant we couldn't do what we wanted to do. Well, the way that sin works is by changing what we want, so that we think we want things which are going to be bad for us. It's very much like addiction. A few years ago, I was chatting to someone from our old church who helped with the soup run, providing food for homeless people. He told me how sad it was seeing some of the drug addicts there. He said that they could have made something of their lives. They were intelligent and skilled people, but they didn't want to. They didn't want to come off the drugs. They didn't want help. Although their lives were hopeless and meaningless, they were so addicted to their drugs that they just didn't want the help to break free. It's very much like that with sin. Sin keeps us in its chains, not by forcing us to comply, but by making us want it. We want to stay in our sins. We want to keep God out of our lives. We want to stay in the darkness. Even if that means we struggle in life, we want to stay in the sins we're addicted to rather than go to the God who loves us. I think pornography is a good example of something which brings sin and addiction together. Porn is wrong, and I think most people in their hearts know it's wrong. At the same time, a lot of people just can't stop watching it. The numbers speak for themselves. It is like an addiction. We also need to remember, as we saw in session 3, that evil is not just an action, but a power, Satan. That's why sin is more addictive than drugs. And who has the resources to fight against Satan? What human being is stronger than him? All this explains why sin is so hard to break out of. Maybe there's a particular sin that you struggle with. Maybe anger, for example. You get frustrated with people and lash out if they let you down. Maybe you've thought in the past, well, today is going to be different. Today I'm going to change. Only to find that changing is much harder than you thought it was going to be. That's because we are addicted to sin, under the power of Satan, and we will never break that addiction without God's help. Fortunately, help is exactly what God can provide.
Hey, Jim!
Excuse me.
That's a bad outfit!
When they were enslaved, the Israelites cried out to God for help. This is what it says in Exodus chapter 2. The Israelites groaned in their slavery and cried out, and their cry for help because of their slavery went up to God. God heard their groaning, and he remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. So God looked on the Israelites and was concerned about them. The Israelites suffered as slaves, and so they cried out to God. God remembered the covenant with Abraham, which we looked at last time, and remembered his promise to bless. So God didn't ignore what was happening to them, but he was moved to action. One of the most important things this short passage teaches us is that the Israelites cried out for help. As we saw with drug addicts earlier, the first step in recovering from addiction is asking for help. And yet many addicts just don't want help. It's the same with sin as well. Many of us simply don't want God's help. We get used to a sinful life and a sinful world. Maybe it's because we're too proud to ask for help. Like how, before the days of sat-nav, it used to be common knowledge that men wouldn't stop and ask for directions. Perhaps men are too proud to show weakness and admit that they're lost. This is why God needs to bring pain and suffering into our life sometimes. He needs to break down our pride and self-reliance. He needs to make us realize the consequences of our sin, so we will turn to him. C.S. Lewis spoke about this in his book, The Problem of Pain. We can rest contentedly in our sins and in our stupidities. And anyone who has watched gluttons shoveling down the most exquisite foods as if they did not know what they were eating will admit that we can ignore even pleasure. But pain insists upon being attended to. God whispers to us in our pleasures, speaks in our conscience, but shouts in our pain. It is his megaphone to rouse a deaf world. God uses pain to break down the barriers we put up against him. Pain is often God's way of bringing people to call out to him for help. I can think of many examples of people who have only become Christian because of something in their own life that they couldn't deal with themselves. We need God's help all the time, but in times of pain and suffering, we realise it more deeply. Johnny Cash expressed it beautifully in his song, Help Me.
I never thought I needed help before. Thought that I could get by myself. But now I know I just can't take it anymore. And with a humble heart on bended knee, begging you please for help.
Johnny Cash thought he didn't need God's help, but in the end, he needed to swallow his pride, come to God, and beg for help. Maybe you felt like that before. The Israelites felt like that because of their slavery, and they cried out to God. So what kind of help does God provide? God raised up a man called Moses, who went to Pharaoh to give him the message, "Let my people go." God said to Pharaoh through Moses that if he didn't let the Israelites go, he would bring plagues against Egypt. You might have heard the story of the 10 plagues. We don't have time to go through them all now, but they got progressively more serious as they went on. And Pharaoh kept on saying no to God's request. The final plague was the death of the firstborn. God warned Pharaoh for the last time that if he didn't let the people go, all of the firstborn children in Egypt would die. Slave or free, rich or poor, even cattle. All of the firstborn across Egypt would die. However, the Israelites would be protected. Let me quote you a short extract from Exodus chapter 12. Then Moses summoned all the elders of Israel and said to them, "Go at once and select the animals for your families, and slaughter the Passover lamb. Take a bunch of hyssop, dip it into the blood in the basin, and put some of the blood on the top and on both sides of the doorframe. None of you shall go out of the door of your house until morning. When the Lord goes through the land to strike down the Egyptians, he will see the blood on the top and sides of the doorframe, and will pass over that doorway. And he will not permit the destroyer to enter your houses and strike you down." The Lord told the people to sacrifice a lamb and paint its blood over the doorframe of their houses. This will be a sign for the Lord not to kill the firstborn within those houses. This was known as the Passover, where the Lord passed over the houses with blood painted over the door. So the blood of the lamb kept people safe from God's just punishment. The death of the lamb was very suggestive of the idea of substitution. The lamb was dying instead of the firstborn. One thing is substituted for another. That's an extremely important theme which we will develop as we go through. The Israelites were not strong enough to fight the Egyptians on their own. They didn't have the weapons or the money or the manpower. And yet God himself was able to fight and bring punishment upon the Egyptians. What the people could not accomplish, God did for them. And they were saved by the sacrifice of a lamb. This was such a significant moment in the Old Testament that God said it was to be the first month of their year, and that the Israelites were commanded to remember it annually with a special festival called the Passover, or the Feast of Unleavened Bread. In fact, Orthodox Jews still celebrate the Passover meal to this day. Christians, however, don't celebrate the Passover. Why not? It's because the Passover has been fulfilled. The Passover is a picture of Christ and what he came to do. Christians don't need to celebrate the Passover because we have Jesus. You don't need a picture if you're looking at the real thing. But we're going to come back to this in the next session. Let's finish by looking at what happened next to the Israelites.
Tell all the Pharaohs to let my people go.
Let my people go.
Well, the 10th plague did have its desired effect. Pharaoh finally listened to God and allowed the Israelites to leave. God brought the Israelites out of Egypt miraculously. Psalm 107 looks back at what God did for the Israelites and praises him for bringing them into freedom. Some sat in darkness, in utter darkness, prisoners suffering in iron chains because they rebelled against God's commands and despised the plans of the Most High. So he subjected them to bitter labour. They stumbled and there was no one to help. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them from their distress. He brought them out of darkness, the utter darkness, and broke away their chains. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for mankind. For he breaks down gates of bronze and cuts through bars of iron. The psalmist paints a picture of prisoners sitting in a dark dungeon, chained up with no one to help. But God broke away their chains and brought them out of the dungeon into light. God took them away from slavery and gave them freedom. Many Christians throughout the centuries have found this to be their experience. Sin offered nothing but enslavement and ultimately death. But God broke in and brought freedom and life. This is exactly the experience which Charles Wesley is describing in his hymn, And Can It Be?
Lord, my imprisoned spirit lay, fast bound in sin and nature's life. Thine I diffuse the quickening ray, my world the
frees us from slavery to sin and brings us to serve him, to live life in the way that he intended in the Garden of Eden. Of course, those who believe in Christ still suffer from the effects of the curse, and yet life is different. We are no longer in chains, slaves to sin. We have a new power to serve God, and we are on the pathway to eternal life. And serving God is not a chore. There's a beautiful collect, a prayer, in the Book of Common Prayer, which begins, O God, who art the author of peace and lover of concord, in knowledge of whom standeth our eternal life, whose service is perfect freedom. Serving God, unlike a human master, is perfect freedom. Freedom in life doesn't mean the freedom to indulge in sin, It means to be free from sin, to serve God. True freedom is found in Him alone. Let's take a moment to pray as we finish this session. And so, Heavenly Father, we thank you for breaking the Israelites out of Egypt, for freeing them from slavery and bringing them to the promised land. And we thank you that you are a God who breaks people out of slavery, and that you can release us from the chains of sin and death and bring us into eternal life. And we pray that you would help us to know more and more what it means to have freedom in Jesus Christ and all that that means for how we live as Christians today. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thanks so much, everyone, for joining me for this session. Don't forget that this is part of a course called What is Christianity? And the previous sessions are available on the YouTube channel already. And if you're watching this later, it will all be available on the YouTube channel. And don't forget to do the whole like, subscribe thing. And you can sign up for a mailing list on the website if you'd like to get a once a week email with any new content on Understand the Bible. Thanks so much, everyone. God bless. And I'll see you again soon.